Good evening, everyone. Good evening. I'm Harold Holzer, director of Roosevelt House, and on behalf of Jennifer Rabb, the president of Hunter College, it's a pleasure and an honor to welcome you to the first fall program of the what feels like a new year. I hope you all had a good summer, or all had good summers, whatever is grammatically correct. I hope you all have noticed the great accomplishment of our summer. Those of you who have been complaining or simply observing about the sidewalk conditions outside for the last year, hopefully notice that we have a beautiful, new, clean sidewalk with no gaps, no holes, and we'll have no water accumulation for any of them. I know, it's exciting. We were going to build a wall, but we decided to build a sidewalk. So this is our first session of the fall. We're going to have many. I hope you join us for as many as you can. And I did want to alert you to something important that is on the back of your programs, and that is that in a few weeks we will be opening a new special exhibit. Having had so much support from you when we did our women's suffrage exhibit, we have a special show of Roosevelt campaign memorabilia from all five, not four, but five of his national campaigns for, or his campaigns for national office, beginning with his vice presidential run with John Cox. So it'll be an interesting show. We'll also have a wall devoted to women who have run for president for obvious reasons to mark the historic nature of the current presidential campaign. And starting with Belva Lockwood on through Margaret Chase Smith and Shirley Chisholm, all in acknowledgement of Eleanor's outreach to women and her milestone role in her husband's campaigns, particularly 1940 when she galvanized the Democratic Convention and was instrumental in getting that third nomination for FDR. So please join us. Tonight, appropriately enough, almost as a lead into our focus on the campaign throughout the fall, which will continue to be our theme for many programs, we welcome someone who knows his politics and his presidential history. Gene Edward Smith was educated at Princeton, is a professor emeritus at the University of Toronto, and also a professor emeritus at Marshall University. I was saying when he addressed our students this afternoon that it's very unusual to find a teacher who is, shall we say, accomplished enough to be a professor emeritus at two different schools. That's pretty remarkable. George Will called him America's greatest living biographer. Whether he continued to think so after the new book, we don't know, but we'll see. We'll check in with him. He has, in fact, written extraordinary biographies of Eisenhower, Grant, and Franklin Roosevelt, which won the last named of those books, won a Francis Parkman Prize, one of the great coveted awards in American history, in 2008. And now his new book, Bush. We joke that it's 25% longer as a title than his FDR book, and hopefully he'll learn to be a little more compact next time around. It's gotten extraordinary reviews. It's stirred up some controversy. It does not shy away from expressing opinions about the Bush presidency, and I think you'll enjoy hearing his unbridled view. So the format for tonight is going to be a little bit different. We will hear from Professor Smith first, following which there will be a moderated discussion at the chairs you see, which will be led by Professor Andrew Polsky, who is the Dean of the School of Arts and Sciences here at Hunter and also a professor of history and aptly enough, author of a book called The American Presidency at War. So that will occur after Gene Smith speaks with us. Following that, as you know is traditional, we welcome all of you to join us upstairs for a reception. You need only buy one book each, which the author is here to sign. So please come afterwards and meet him upstairs and get this book. Get someone to help you carry it home. It's a big book. And a big book about a really important subject, and it could not have been tackled by a more accomplished scholar. Please welcome my friend Gene Edward Smith.
Harold mentioned that my biography of FDR won the Francis Parkman Prize at the Society of American Historians. I was the 50th winner of the prize, and so I checked who else had won and what the books were. I was number 50, but I was the 13th who had written the biography of Franklin Roosevelt. George Bush would not grant me an interview for the book. I interviewed Cheney a half dozen times, and Cheney said, "I'll set up an interview for you with the president." And so I was prepared to go out to Dallas to meet with him. And about two or three days before, I got a telephone call from one of Bush's aides who said, "The president has decided he doesn't want to see you. You wrote a book that's critical of his father, and so he doesn't want to see you," which is true. In 1992, I published a book called George Bush's War, so I didn't go out. Now, before I begin in talking about Bush, let me make two comments to sort of put all of this in context. First, when it came to national security, Bush was absolutely in charge. The decisions were his. He was indeed the decider. After 9/11, he relished his role as being commander-in-chief, and everything became chain of command. Bush was not a tool of Cheney, or of Condoleezza Rice, or of the neocons, or of anyone else. He was a driving force. Whether it was CIA renditions, or NSA snooping, or the war in Iraq, these were all personal decisions taken by the president. Bush was able to do this because of the growth of the National Security Council staff over the last 50 years. The National Security Council was established by the 80th Congress in 1947. Now, this is a Republican 80th Congress. And they did so to strip power away from the White House after Roosevelt's use in the Second World War. It was modeled after the British War Cabinet, and it was intended to bring the Secretary of State and the Secretary of Defense and others in contact with the president, and similar to the British War Cabinet, and to keep presidential decisions narrowly confined. That was the National Security Council. Truman used it that way. Eisenhower used it that way. Neither of the two had a national security advisor. Changed when John Kennedy became president and appointed McGeorge Bundy his national security advisor. And they established a professional staff of about 20 people, not under Truman, not under Eisenhower. After Kissinger became national security advisor to Nixon, the size of the staff doubled. And by the time that Bush became president, the staff of the National Security Council numbered over 100, with another 100 people attached to it from the professional departments. In other words, the National Security Act of 1949 and the purpose of the National Security Council had really been turned upside down. And rather than restricting what the president could do, the National Security Council really facilitated Bush's action. Bush ran policy from the White House. The National Security Council staff enabled him to do so. The second point I would like to make in beginning is that George W. Bush was a born-again Christian. saw the world in biblical terms. This was especially true after 9/11. Bush defined the battle against terrorism as a struggle between good and evil, and saw himself as God's agent put here on earth to defeat the forces of Satan. Just before the war in Iraq, Bush called President Chirac of France on the telephone and told him that the war against Saddam was going to be the final struggle for civilization at the end of time. That Gog and Magog were at work in the Middle East, and that this was the struggle depicted in the book of Revelation before the final judgment. Now, Chirac didn't know what Bush was talking about. And when his aides deciphered it, it convinced him all the more that he didn't want any part of it. In a later interview, Chirac in 2009 said he was stupefied by Bush's invocation of biblical prophecy and wondered how anyone could be so superficial and fanatical in their beliefs. Let me suggest that it was Bush's religious fixation that is the common denominator behind the domestic excesses of the administration and the foreign policy blunders. If you believe that you are God's agent, no holes are barred. Now, the contrast to Abraham Lincoln is interesting. Lincoln, after the Battle of Bull Run in 1861, was visited by a delegation of Protestant clergymen, one of whom told the president that he'd had a vision from heaven the night before, and the Lord had said he was on Lincoln's side. And Lincoln said, "That's mighty fine, but what I really need is Kentucky." I'll say just a word or two about Bush's education. Bush was Yale class of 1968. Bush was a fourth generation legacy, and at that time, Yale was taking 52% of the legacy applicants. Harvard and Princeton were taking about 15%. In Bush's freshman year, Kingman Brewster became president of Yale and changed the rules and decided that Yale would simply take the same number of legacy applicants as Princeton and Harvard, 15%. So Bush's three brothers and his sister, all of whom had the same legacy credentials as he did not get into Yale because Brewster had changed the rules. Let me also say a word about Bush also went to the Harvard Business School and entered in 1973, 5 years after he graduated from Yale. Bush had interviews with 53 Fortune 500 companies at Harvard and did not get a job offer. One of Bush's classmates said that they considered him dynamically ignorant. Anyway, after Harvard Law School, Bush returned to Texas and, like his father, went into the oil business, buying leases on property, hoping to strike oil. In 1997, he married Laura Welsh, and the following year ran for Congress as a Republican nominee to succeed retiring Congressman George Mahon, who was the Dean of the House at the time. Bush lost the election and went into the oil business, profited for several years through family connections, but the downturn in prices hit hard and Bush eventually sold out. It was during that period that Bush became a born-again Christian. In his memoirs, Bush credits Billy Graham with his conversion, Actually, it came a year earlier with a lesser-known evangelist named Arthur Blissett, was known as the man who'd carried the cross around the world. This was also the time that Bush gave up drinking. Now, he drank very heavily prior to this. In fact, I believe it was Laura who said he said the three B's bourbon, beer, and brandy. But in any event, this was on celebrating his 40th birthday at the Broadmoor Hotel in Colorado, in the Colorado Springs, with several of his friends. They had a very alcoholic evening. Bush woke up with an incredible hangover and decided to stop drinking. Laura said it was because he got the bill for that previous evening's celebration. Actually, it was because George recognized he had a problem. This was 1986. His father was gearing up to run for Congress, to run for president against after Reagan retired. And he didn't want to embarrass his father, so he stopped drinking. No longer in the oil business, George moved to Washington in 86 to help his father's campaign. He was given an office at campaign headquarters between Lee Atwater, who was running the campaign, and Roger Ailes, who was handling the media. And for the next year, 2 years, George really learned about presidential politics from two highly gifted practitioners, Atwater and Ailes. Poppy ran against Dukakis, and George saw really how to run a presidential campaign. When the election was over in November of 88, George declined an appointment to work in his father's administration, returned to Texas, started an informal campaign to run for governor, and at the same time organized a syndicate to buy the Texas Rangers. The Rangers were the former Washington Senators, an expansion team which had been formed in 1961, and moved to Texas in 1972. The deal came through. Bush stepped back from running for governor, and for the next 4 years was the public head of the Texas Rangers. The public head of the Texas Rangers built a new stadium and basked in the glow of an improving franchise. Bush assisted in his father's reelection bid in 1992 from a distance, and when Clinton won that election, set his sights on running for governor of Texas. Jeb, at the same time, brother Jeb, decided to run for governor of Florida. Bush was running against incumbent Ann Richards in Texas, and Ann Richards was heavily favored. Jeb was running against, was favored to defeat the Democratic incumbent Lawton Childs in Florida. But the election was an upset. George won in Texas, Jeb lost in Florida. Now, Texas is the second largest state, both in area and in population. But the governor of Texas has no executive authority. Let me say that again. The governor of Texas has no executive authority. This change took place after Reconstruction, when the new Texas Constitution came into place after Reconstruction. All power was stripped from the governor's office. The governor of Texas is essentially a ceremonial figure, like the Queen of England. Most scholars of state government consider the governorship of Texas the weakest in the nation. Now, in that setting, Bush thrived. As the symbolic leader of Texas, he was widely applauded, was overwhelmingly elected when he ran for re-election in 1998. He also built an effective political machine, including Karl Rove, Karen Hughes, and was quietly exploring the possibility of running for president in 2000. Bush announced his candidacy in June of 1999, defeated McCain in the primaries, and was nominated almost unanimously by the Republican convention 16 years ago. Al Gore was the Democratic nominee and heavily favored. Heavily favored. The American Political Science Association meeting in Washington 16 years ago in the summer, over the political scientists who handle these speculate on elections overwhelmingly said that Gore was going to win, but Gore fumbled. He chose Joseph Lieberman, the most conservative Democrat in the Senate, as his running mate. Snubbed Bill Clinton, who was still president and would not let Clinton take any part in the campaign, and did poorly in his three television debates with Bush. The choice of Lieberman and the snubbing of Clinton gave Ralph Nader an enormous opening on the left. He would ultimately pull almost 3 million votes, and the election came down to Florida. Gore failed to carry 10 states that Clinton had carried in the 1996 election, including his home state of Tennessee, any one of which would have put him over the top. And as you know, the Supreme Court ultimately decided on December 12th the issue, and George Bush became president. Bush was superb as a politician seeking votes, but he had no executive experience, little knowledge of international affairs, had not really traveled abroad, a short attention span, and genuinely believed that he was God's agent and that this was a mission given to him by the Almighty. With the exception of selecting Colin Powell to be Secretary of State and Don Rumsfeld to be Secretary of Defense, and his friend Don Evans to be Secretary of Commerce, he delegated the selection of his cabinet and other top-level officials to Dick Cheney and closeted himself in the White House with his staff from the governor's office in Texas, plus Condoleezza Rice as his national security advisor and Andy Card as his chief of staff. Now, if you think about it, it is inconceivable that Franklin Roosevelt would have trusted John Nance Garner with the selection of his cabinet. Or that Dwight Eisenhower would have trusted Richard Nixon with the selection of his cabinet. As a result of Cheney's input, Bush took office with a phalanx of sub-cabinet appointees who were powerfully motivated and already equipped to provide the intellectual justification for the president's policies. These people were conservative in outlook, crisply articulate, like-minded ideologues, and longtime friends. Scooter Libby, Paul Wolfowitz, Elliot Abrams, for example. Cheney played a very important role during the first 2 years of Bush's administration. He had an office in the White House. The staff was integrated with Bush's staff. They were all White House staff. The administration's position on energy, the revision of the tax code, and after 9/11, the decision to the presidential directive to try captured al-Qaeda members by military commissions all reflected Cheney's input. But over the years, Cheney's influence diminished. Initially, Bush concentrated on domestic issues. The United States under Clinton had run a budget surplus for the last 3 years. Clinton had applied the surplus to reducing the federal deficit. Bush insisted the surplus should be returned to the people. You may recall he often on the campaign trail said, it's your money. Treasury Secretary Paul O'Neill and Fed Chairman Alan Greenspan wanted a trigger in the act to reduce, to curtail the tax deduction if the surplus failed, but Bush said no. And at Bush's urging, Congress enacted one of the largest tax cuts in American history. He signed it in June 2001, and in July, the budget surplus disappeared. He also pressed educational reform, in this case, No Child Left Behind, which Congress also enacted that first year. Bush did not touch foreign policy issues really during that first year, except he did so with an incredible, the Clinton administration in South Korea had been at work since 1994 to bring North Korea back into the family of nations. North Korea had agreed to reduce its nuclear arsenal. The United States and South Korea would provide financial assistance to North Korea. Madeleine Albright, Clinton's outgoing Secretary of State, visited Pyongyang in December of 2000 after the election, but before the inauguration. South Korean President Kim Dae-jung visited Washington in March of 2001. They were intent on pressing the agreement with North Korea by which North Korea would renounce nuclear weapons, sign a peace treaty with South Korea. And that was just about complete until Bush heard about it. And Bush said that the Chinese government was evil, it had to be replaced, and there was nothing further to do. Now, the problem that we face today with South Korea is directly attributable to Bush's personal decision to break off negotiations with North Korea, as you know, one of the evil people. Bush also rejected the Kyoto Protocol on global warming, the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, and the International Criminal Court. The attacks of 9/11 were a surprise, but merely reinforced Bush's view of good versus evil. In many respects, let me suggest that 9/11 has been a defining moment in American history. By conflating the attacks with Saddam Hussein, Bush led the United States into a $3 trillion war in Iraq, promulgated a doctrine of preventive war, alienated America's allies, weakened its alliances, inspired young Muslims throughout the world to join the jihad. Domestically, the hysteria released by the Bush administration undermined civil liberty, eroded the rule of law, and tarnished respect for traditional American values. On September 12th, Bush assumed total control and total responsibility as the nation's commander-in-chief. Cheney offered that morning, on the 12th, to head a group of cabinet officers to devise policy for Bush, and Bush rejected the offer. "This is a job for the commander-in-chief and cannot be delegated," said the president. Rather than treat the events of 9/11 as isolated incidents, rather than handle them through the legal process, Bush depicted them as acts of war by the forces of evil. I won't go into Bush's attacks on American civil liberty. I devote two chapters in the book to NASA spying, the torture trail, and the record is clear. Bush genuinely believed that he was fighting the forces of Satan, and as a result, there were no barriers as to what could be done. Whether it was enhanced interrogation techniques, extraordinary renditions, or the intercepts of private conversations, communications in the United States, Bush thought he was God's agent in the final fight to rid the world of evil. Let me say a word or two about the war in Iraq. Bush was determined to remove Saddam Hussein. The intervention in Afghanistan was simply a warm-up. He instructed the Defense Department to prepare to invade Iraq and ignored the findings of UN weapons inspectors Hans Blick and Mohammed al-Baradi that Saddam Hussein had no weapons of mass destruction. Bush also rejected the objections of France, Germany, Russia, China, and Canada, and ignored the UN Security Council totally. Among major world powers, only Great Britain supported the United States, and Britain's collaboration has been heavily condemned, as you know, by the recent Chilcot report of the Privy Council. Planning for the invasion began early in 2002. The military assumed that the purpose was to remove Saddam Hussein, destroy whatever weapons of mass destruction might be found, and leave Iraq as soon as possible. Rumsfeld, Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld, and Tommy Franks, who was commanding U.S. forces, believed that 90 days should be sufficient, and that's what the military planned for. The invasion took place, Saddam was toppled, the military began to withdraw, leaving it to the Iraqis to work things out. As both State Department and the Defense Department saw it, Iraq had been liberated, and it was up to the Iraqis to move ahead. The Ba'athist Party remained in control. The army remained in place. The Iraqi army remained in place under American tutelage, and a senior leadership council had been established by General J. Garner, and was developing plans for a new government. Iraq was still a secular state. But on May 1st, 2003. Speaking on the flight deck of the Abraham Lincoln, and you'll recall that's under that banner that said mission accomplished, Bush said that the purpose of the invasion was to bring democracy to Iraq, and that American forces would remain there until that was accomplished. Bush changed the mission without consulting anyone. The decision was unilateral. Instead of being liberators, the Army would become occupiers and would bring democracy to Iraq. Rumsfeld, Franks, Powell were dumbfounded but acquiesced. Now, let me digress just for a moment to explain the difference between being liberators and occupiers. Liberators set a country free. Occupiers impose their will. In World War II, Eisenhower didn't want to be bothered governing French territory that was taken back from the Germans. And so over FDR's vigorous objection, he brought de Gaulle into France and trusted de Gaulle and the Free French to govern the territory taken back. France was liberated. On the other hand, Germany, when they crossed into Germany, all government was disbanded and the Allies became occupying powers. It's an important distinction. And Bush made that choice on his own. As for Iraq, the Defense Department, the State Department, and all the military assumed they were liberating Iraq from Saddam and that the Iraqis would work things out after he was gone. Then on May 1st, Bush unilaterally changed the direction, and the Allied forces became occupiers instead of liberators. It was downhill from that point on. Paul Bremer was appointed to head the occupation as the president's representative. The Ba'athist Party was outlawed. The Iraqi army was disbanded. Most government offices were closed. Bremer reported directly to the White House. And the defense, not to the Defense Department or to the State Department. Coalition forces became occupiers, and for many Iraqis, they became the enemy at that point. The rise of ISIS traces really to that change. Donald Trump recently said that Obama and Hillary really were the founders of ISIS. The fact is, it was George W. Bush who bears the original responsibility for the rise of ISIS when he deposed Saddam Hussein. Let me say just a word or two about the incidents at the Abu Ghraib prison. We all saw those hideous photos. What we did not know was that the military guards who were committing those outrages had been encouraged by the CIA and military intelligence to rough up the prisoners before they were integrated. This wasn't something that the guards did on their own. Four subsequent military investigations, which have been downplayed to some degree, have documented clearly that the outrages we saw were a deliberate effort to break the will of the prisoners before they were integrated. By 2006, Bush had become deeply disturbed about the situation in Iraq. He authorized a surge in the number of U.S. troops to regain the initiative, and the surge helped. But it wasn't not the most decisive factor in restoring order. Far more important were the Anbar Awakening, in which the Sunni leadership of Anbar province turned against the radical Islamic State, and the decision of Shiite cleric Muhammad al-Sadr at the urging of Iran to demobilize his Mahdi army and stand down. But by any event, by the end of 2007, a semblance of order had been achieved. And in late 2008, before he left office, Bush went to Baghdad to sign an agreement with Prime Minister Maliki, providing for the withdrawal of U.S. forces from Iraq by the end of 2011. That, you will recall, was when a disgruntled Iraqi threw his shoes at Bush. Let me suggest that Bush's decision to invade Iraq was the worst foreign policy decision ever made by an American president. Thank you. There's a Democratic audience over here. That does not mean that America, that Bush was America's worst president. When I started writing the book, I sort of thought that was the case, but I became convinced that that was not the case. Bush's domestic accomplishments are significant. No Child Left Behind has been a valuable addition to the educational program in the United States, particularly for children from disadvantaged families. The amendment of Medicare to provide prescription drugs for seniors is a remarkable achievement. Bush also pressed for immigration reform, was a friend of the Latino population, and also was not racially prejudiced. He took the lead in the global fight against AIDS, particularly in Africa, and under his leadership, the disease has been brought under control. At Bush's urging, Congress appropriated over $50 billion to fight AIDS, and Bush remains active in the fight. He also expanded American free trade. When Bush took office, the United States had free trade agreements with Canada, Mexico, and Israel. When he left office, free trade agreements existed with 16 countries. Bush also concluded an agreement with Putin to reduce the nuclear arsenal that each country maintained and improve relations with China. But I think Bush's most important accomplishment came in 2008, confronting the economic meltdown. Against all of his instincts and deeply held beliefs, Bush bailed out Wall Street and the American auto industry and avoided another Great Depression. Unlike the war against Iraq or the fight against terrorists, Bush this time listened to his advisors, Hank Paulson, the Secretary of the Treasury, Ben Bernanke, the Chairman of the Federal Reserve, carved out a strategy of support, and Bush accepted it. From bailing out subprime mortgage lenders and insurance conglomerates to rescuing the market itself with a troubled asset relief program, Bush deserves credit for taking the necessary actions. It's a remarkable achievement and probably saved the world's economy. Why they failed to rescue Lehman Brothers is really more attributable to Paulson than to Bush. Now, I don't, maybe I shouldn't explain that. The friction between Goldman Sachs, which Paulson headed, and Lehman Brothers is a historic fact. I'll leave it at that. I haven't said anything. My first biography was about General Lucius Clay, and the military governor of Germany, the founder of the Berlin Airlift, and all that business. After a digression. After the war was over, after he came back from that, Clay became first head of Continental Can, and then Bobby Lehman asked him to go down and become head of Lehman Brothers. And Clay, at that time, was a very close friend of the head of Goldman Sachs. And Clay said, he never spoke to me again. So I'll just leave it at that. I haven't said anything about Bush's personal life. Let me be very, very brief. Bush was always an early riser, getting up each morning at 6:45, going to bed shortly before 10. He was a physical fitness buff, exercised for 2 hours daily in the White House. He was also not a detail man. He wanted short memos and brief descriptions. He and Laura were close and kept White House entertaining to a maximum. I haven't said anything about Laura, really, I do in the book, but she was a major source of support for Bush. She took her responsibilities seriously and accompanied Bush on his trips abroad and provided great comfort for him. Let me conclude by saying that as an ex-president, Bush has been exemplary. Unlike most of his predecessors, he does not miss the office and does not try to second-guess Obama. "Free at last," Bush said when he saw Obama take the oath of office. and in many respects, he has been a model of what ex-president should be. As I said, I don't think Bush was America's worst president, but I do think his decision to attack Iraq was the worst foreign policy decision ever made by an American president. And because of ISIS, it gets worse as time goes on. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Gene, for the overview of the book. There's a lot more in the book, so I highly recommend it. I'd like to begin with a question about your role as a biographer. It's, as you said, you started this project thinking that George W. Bush may have been the worst president that the United States ever had, and you softened your judgment a little as the project went on. Is it more difficult when you're writing a biography to write one about someone when you have a low opinion of your subject? And how does that change the work of writing the biography?
Oh, yes, it very definitely does. Normally, when you write a biography, it's about someone you admire. John Marshall, Grant, Roosevelt, FDR, Eisenhower. And it may have been a mistake for me to do the Bush book. I had just...
No, it wasn't.
I had just finished the Eisenhower book. I was here in New York. I was having lunch with my editor, and he said, we were having lunch, and he said, what do you want to do next? And just off the top of my head, I said, well, why not George W. Bush? And it wasn't a calculated decision.
So do you find it difficult under these circumstances to be fair to your subject? You sort of bend over backwards to try and give him the benefit of the doubt.
Yes, I did that. I didn't find it difficult to be fair to him, but that's why I say I changed my view in terms of his total accomplishments as president, because I thought his domestic accomplishments were significant.
Bush has a reputation as a president who did not pay much attention to details or engage very much in serious reflection, but you describe several cases in the book where that was not the case, where in fact he deeply immersed himself in thinking about an issue, like, for example, the stem cell debate, the stem cell question early on. Why was he careful and thoughtful at some points, but not others?
Well, the stem cell issue, which arose during Bush's first year, it was an issue that also brought his religious views, that reflected Bush's religious views. And I think he recognized, and I think Laura as well, I think Bush recognized what was involved in this issue and wanted to be very careful in what he decided. I think he was much more balanced when it came to dealing with domestic issues than it was the foreign policy issue.
Maybe this is also about domestic policy, though there are some exceptions. And you talked about it here at the end. You gave him credit for a number of things: Medicare prescription coverage, the American effort to support the campaign against AIDS in Africa. He supported the government rescue of the banks and the automakers in the wake of the fiscal collapse in his last year in office. Was there a unifying thread, ideological thread, to his presidency? Because these points certainly seem to be deviations from what we would think of as some of the conventional Republican Party ideology of his time. Are they just deviations, or is there some, what is it that holds together? What's the common thread that links together the pieces of the presidency?
In many respects, Bush was on the left wing of the Republican Party in terms of his domestic accomplishments. And he had great difficulty getting the prescription drug bill passed through Congress. So I think that Bush was on the left wing of the Republican Party, and insofar as domestic issues were concerned, and Bush's position on immigration and its relationship to the Latino population, Bush often said family values don't end at the Rio Grande. Bush, because as he had grown up in Texas, was very close to the Latino community, and did very well in the election in the Latino community, and I think genuinely believe that.
We need to spend some time talking about the war in Iraq, which is such a driving part of his presidency and a central part of the book. Let me begin. First of all, let me take up Donald Rumsfeld and the difference, if you will, between Rumsfeld and Bush. In the 2000 presidential election, Bush openly said that the United States should move away from nation building. That was not the not our role. And Rumsfeld embraced that. Rumsfeld never deviated, as far as I can see, from his commitment that the United States should not engage in nation building.
Absolutely correct.
Right. Why did Bush? What was it that made him decide? In some ways, he believed. You make this point that Iraq was a model that could spread throughout the Middle East, a place where democracy could take hold, where liberal values could take hold. But he also believed that would happen, or he said that would happen naturally. In his view, people longed for liberty, and all you had to do was give them the opportunity. Did that change? Did he remain committed to the notion that the Iraqis would find the way on their way on their own?
Well, I think that Bush, to begin with, was not aware of the religious visions that existed in Iraq, and was unaware of how to deal with that. But I think that Rumsfeld and the military believed were not part of this idea of spreading democracy around the world. This was something that Bush learned from professors of history at Yale and from several evangelists, and Bush became convinced that this was a thing that he should do. I think he got there because his own awareness of what the world was like was very limited. But Bush, prior to becoming president, really had only been abroad twice. He went once to Israel and he went once to China, and that was it. Bush did not know anything about the world. During the election in 2000, he asked Wolfowitz, "Is Germany a member of NATO?" I mean, in 2000.
So let me pursue the Iraq theme a little bit longer. Let's go up to 2006. The war is going badly. The insurgency has expanded. There are very heavy casualties among the Iraqis. American casualties are quite substantial. The general consensus in the military is the United States should begin to move toward the exit doors and start to withdraw troops. Bush decides otherwise. He instead favors the surge. Was there a better choice? Did he make the right call in 2006 when he decided to send more troops?
I don't want to go there. You mentioned the military was in favor of withdrawing. The military was in favor of withdrawing from the day that this thing started. I mean, they thought they would be there for 90 days and that would be it. And that did not change. They continued to believe that. Bush effectively ignored it. The military was not in favor of the surge.
Right, that's right. That was something that Bush did with the support of some members of his yep. White House team yep. and some ex-military people. Yep. I want to push you a little on the question. Was it the right call? The Iraq Study Group said no, withdraw. But you say that it was one of the factors that did contribute to the lessening of violence in Iraq.
Well, yes, but it was a minor factor. Far more important were the Anbar Awakening and the fact that the Mahdi Army was disbanded. So it was not nearly as important as Fox News would like us to believe. If that's
all right. One. Let me ask you one final question about the way he conducted the wars, and that is, you say the United States kept too many troops in Iraq. It was an occupier rather than a liberator.
Yes.
If you look at Afghanistan, the pattern was the opposite. In Afghanistan, the United States left very few troops. But there again, essentially, chaos followed. Was that the right thing to do in Afghanistan? If it was wrong to send to put more troops in Iraq, what about Afghanistan?
Well, don't forget, in Afghanistan, the United States was supported by virtually every country in the world. And this was a coalition effort in Afghanistan, which Iraq was not. So I think you're dealing with a much different situation. And I think that Bush's decision to go into Iraq cut short the efforts in Afghanistan and prevented the Allies from restructuring Afghanistan as they might have done if they had not gone into Iraq. Now let me say a word about Saddam Hussein, if I may. Saddam Hussein was a terrible dictator, but he kept the lid on. Is it the business of the United States to go into other countries and try to change the government because we think this is a dictatorship and not a democracy? I mean, it seems to me that's very foolish.
I'm about to open it up for questions from the audience, but I'm going to ask you one more very difficult question. Can you give us a kind word about Dick Cheney? Just one.
Yes, absolutely. I interviewed Cheney six times, and I found him very easy to interview. The only limitation on anything I asked, he said, "Don't quote me unless you show me what it's going to be." And I found Cheney to be perfectly fine as an individual. I think George Bush is perfectly fine as an individual. People are like that personally.
All right, we are going to take questions. I'm going to ask you to wait for the microphone. We have microphone back there. Good. Wait for the microphone. We're looking for questions rather than speeches, and a long statement followed by raising your voice like you're Canadian is not really a question. All right, so let's please keep the statement short and come to a real question. Let me start over here. Wait, take the microphone if you don't mind. Thank you.
I recently moved here from Washington, D.C. Would you address these two issues? And this was definitely discussed in Washington everywhere. It was Rumsfeld who did not want to go past 90 days. The generals had to fight him. They wanted to plan a contingency plan after the 90 days, and he basically said no. So that took that off the table. The other thing is when Bush was elected in November, it was Wolfowitz, Rumsfeld and Cheney, who were already making plans. I mean, this was discussed all over Washington, that they already were making plans to get rid of Saddam. Did any of that come up in your research?
No. It didn't. I'm not sure I should say this. I have known Don Rumsfeld since September of 1950. He and I were freshmen in the same class at Princeton. We lived in the same entry, and I have known him that long. In fact, when he wrote his book, Known and Unknown, I read all the chapters before it went to press. And he and I are close. And I don't think he believed that. I don't think, and don't forget, Rumsfeld was not Bush's first choice to be Secretary of Defense. Rumsfeld was supposed to go over to the CIA or somewhere. And it was only after Bush's first choice to become Defense Secretary, the head of FedEx, had a heart attack and therefore couldn't take it, that Rumsfeld did become Secretary of Defense, and that was over George Herbert Walker Bush's strenuous objections, and so I don't think that this was. Now, Wolfowitz, yes, perhaps, probably so, but I don't think Cheney and Rumsfeld. I don't think Cheney and Rumsfeld were diehard to go to war. Wolfowitz, very likely. So I'm saying yes for one and no for two.
Okay, let me go to the back on this side.
Just a couple of short questions. The United States was, during the Bush administration, right after he was elected, was repeatedly warned that Al-Qaeda would be attacking on U.S. soil and did nothing to prevent that. Isn't it fair to say he was asleep at the wheel and allowed 9/11 to happen? And then on that fateful day in November when Floridians went to vote in 2000, we all know Al Gore got more votes than George Bush. And isn't it fair to say that the Bush Nazis stole that election for their ne'er-do-well son?
Okay. I think the question here that we'd like you to address is whether or not Bush should have done more to prevent 9/11 or to deal with the Al-Qaeda threat ahead of time, and he wasn't paying attention.
Well, of course, the CIA did inform Bush several times, a number of times, of the danger and so forth. And one day down in at the ranch in Texas, devoted an entire briefing to the threat that Al Qaeda posed. But Bush was not involved in foreign policy. Bush was a concerned about domestic issues, and. I don't think he can be faulted that much for it.
Hang on. No. No follow-ups. I'm sorry. We have others who are waiting to ask questions. Let's take another one from the back, and then we'll come up front.
Thank you, Professor Smith, for your talk. Just quick question. Why do you think we put all the blame on Cheney? You started by saying that this was all Bush, and yet we always talk about Cheney or these other guys.
That's partially Cheney's fault to some degree. I think in the beginning, the newsmen did focus on Cheney, and legitimately so, because don't forget, Bush had not been in Washington. He didn't know what Washington was like. Cheney staffed the administration, and so Cheney did play a very important role, really up to 9/11. And I think that the press simply continued with that and to believe it that would continue to be so. But gradually Cheney's role diminished significantly, and of course the Scooter Libby affair was a major drawback for Cheney.
All right, we'll come up to the front. Wait for the microphone. We'll go here.
In the book, you describe how Bush relied on the reports and advisories from the Office of Legal Counsel, from John Yoo and others there. And that was the narrow group to whom he turned for advice about enhanced interrogation and other executive powers that he thought he had. It took the Supreme Court years to change that. Do you get a sense from the Bush presidency that our checks and balances system of government has fallen apart in the face of an executive who's willing to go as far as Bush did?
Well, I think it fell apart initially, but I think that the Supreme Court reasserted our values, and so I think it's always a danger when a crisis hits. You can look at FDR. It is always a danger when crisis hits, but I think we've rallied in that respect. You might say, why do we still have people in Guantanamo? And that's certainly a legitimate question. And it's curious, isn't it, that Obama took office 8 years ago, determined to end the prisoners in Guantanamo, and they're still there. So yes.
How about we go?
Is it fair to say that because they approved the use of torture, Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, and Wolfowitz are war criminals?
I pass. It's a legitimate question, and I think there's no easy answer to it. I don't think you can automatically say no.
Your evaluation of Bush began with thinking him the worst president, but you indicated that the hierarchy of worst has changed. Who do you now put into that position? Who is the worst president?
Oh, I think Herbert Hoover has that locked up. And that convinced me as I was going on. You've really got to do things pretty badly to beat Herbert Hoover. And I'll leave it at that.
Let's go one row back.
Would you say domestically, the failure to put two tax cuts and the drug program in the budget and borrow for those, and even the Social Security attempting to privatize it, were failings of his domestic policy and almost led to the need for Bernanke and Paulson to come up with a salvation package so that we don't go over the cliff?
Well, that's exactly right. Yes, Bush accepted what Paulson and Bernanke were telling him because I think by 2008, I think he realized he was over his head as president. And I think he was not prepared to press his own view. And so I think he listened to what Bernanke and Paulson were saying.
But does that tarnish his domestic achievements that you pointed out? And not putting those two tax cuts in the budget creates a deficit. Not having negotiations for drug prices has kept Medicare pretty high. And even wanting to privatize Social Security, fortunately, from my perspective, it doesn't go through. For me, that really weakens his domestic, as opposed to giving him credibility.
Oh, sure. Look, I'm not saying that he's Franklin Roosevelt. I'm just saying that he did some things that were good.
Okay, sure. So we have time. I'm sorry, for only one more question, and it will be yours.
Thank you. First of all, I think has been a fascinating and wonderful presentation, so thank you for that. Secondly, I wondered in your research if you found the extent to which the neocons, Wolfowitz, Pearl, Cheney himself, Strauss, etc., contributed to the selection of Bush as a candidate for president and Bush's selection of vice president, which enabled him to staff the cabinet, as you said, and then the fact that Bush carried out the agenda of the Project for a New American Century, which was the agenda of the neoconservatives to impose democracy on the Middle East through keeping the world in a perpetual state of war.
I'll sum up the question. How much of this, the problems of the Bush presidency, can we lay at the feet of the neocons around Bush? Are they the ones who are primarily to blame for what went wrong in this administration?
That's a superb question, and I don't think so. I think that what the neocons did was to justify what Bush wanted to do. I don't think they were the prime movers. I think that Bush made the decisions. And the neocons then articulated it and put the arguments together to support it. But I believe that it was Bush himself who made the decisions.
We need to go upstairs, but we can continue the debate upstairs. Please join me in thanking Dean Andy Polsky and Gene Edward Smith. Please join us upstairs and thank you.